I'm Nina Sachdev, Director of Communications for MIF. I am here with filmmaker Nancy Schwartzman. Can you hear us, Nancy?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, great.
I'm also here with Rachel DeLeon, a reporter and producer at the Center for Investigative Reporting. Rachel, thanks for joining us. For our last session of the day, we're going to be discussing Nancy's film, Victim Suspect, which follows a reporter, Ray, as she uncovers a nationwide pattern of women who report their sexual assault to the police, but are then charged with making a false report. Then, in some cases, they're arrested, and then some cases even put in jail. Victim Suspect premiered at the Sundance Film Festival back in January and has since found a home on Netflix. So before we watch the trailer, I just want to acknowledge that rape is not a topic that we've discussed very often in this space. It's difficult to discuss and it can be triggering. But as we've heard from speakers earlier today, like Imara and Jose, not being listened to and not being believed, it has dire consequences for the victim, for society, and for democracy. So we're gonna discuss it right here, right now. Because what I heard from my meditation podcast this morning, what you resist persists. So let's get into it. And we'll watch the trailer first and then go to questions.
Was there a point, like, with the investigation where you felt like the police just, you knew they weren't believing you, and...
The detective told me he didn't hold you down, that's about rape.
If you continue to lie to me, this is about to go south. I do not believe you. I do not believe you at all. It is a crime to file that false report.
I was raped, and they told me I lied about it.
I've been working on this story for 4 years. I managed to gather more than 160 cases where alleged victims of sexual assault were turned into suspects.
Filing a false report is a Class A misdemeanor, punishable up to 1 year in jail.
The women had pled guilty. There was sort of a knee-jerk sense, well, they pled guilty. They admitted it. There's no story here.
But when I spoke to them, they maintained that the assaults did happen.
Was it wanted? Was it consensual? No.
From the investigation, you're not being honest with me, okay?
Well, what I just told you?
Yes. And I think you're one of those people that's taken away from my true victims.
It's only in the details that you start seeing how a reporting victim becomes a suspect.
They will turn to those interrogation tactics that are designed to elicit confessions from suspects.
How can you tell me that I'm lying to you when there are no cameras?
Getting the victim to retract their allegations is such an important strategy because they haven't actually investigated the sexual assault thoroughly. So the message that they send to all the sexual assault survivors in their community is that if the police don't believe you, they might prosecute you.
Once your name is in the press, it's everywhere. Because you're no longer a sexual assault victim, you do not have that right to privacy anymore. These young women have no idea. There is an institution of people who allow it to happen.
I was the one who said to her, baby, you need to go to the cops. You do everything that you're supposed to, and things like that happen, you know? Sometimes the justice system is not made for everybody.
So, yeah. Ray, let's start with you, because, I mean, that is... pretty shocking story that you uncovered, and the story originated with your reporting. And like you said, bless you, Nancy. you've been working on it for 4 years. I think you were a year into it before you met Nancy. What exactly did you uncover? I think people are wondering, how on earth does a victim become a suspect?
So what I was finding and why I thought that this would make a documentary was the videos that I was gathering, which thank God for good public record access in certain states, because I was able to watch and see actually how that was happening. Sometimes the people, usually young women, were coming into the room starting off as a suspect. They didn't know that, of course. But by the way that the detective was getting into it, you can tell he's setting them up for a confession. Other times, you could see it sort of unravel, like, in the process. You could see how the questions were becoming less open-ended and more like, well, why didn't you do this, and why this, and why this? Very, like, cornering them. So in the examples in the film, it often comes down to, like, inconsistencies, which is extremely normal and should be expected in investigations of rape and sexual assault. Or like prior consensual kind of activity, which doesn't prove anything one way or the other. So it, I mean, I'll boil it down just to ignorance, misunderstandings, and then these detectives get angry. They're mad, you know. In that trailer you saw, the detective is like, you're wasting my time. So oftentimes on that arrest record, you'll see that the victim is actually the state of Alabama, the state of Connecticut, because the resources were wasted. So that's broadly how it happens, but what was great is that in the videos you could see, you know, how those questions are being asked. And on the other side, you know, when I did get to speak to those young women, I could understand completely their confusion and just like total surprise that they were the ones that were gonna be handcuffed at the end of it. Oftentimes without even a suspect being interviewed at all, like a rape suspect. Mm.
So, Nancy, let's provide a little bit of context for a minute. This isn't your first film that takes a deep dive into sexual assault. In 2018, you directed Roll Red Roll, a documentary about a high school rape in Ohio. And before that, you examined your own personal story in The Line. And I think the way that you capture how rape culture excuses and normalizes and tolerates sexual violence is really clear and compelling. And you've created this body of work that helps explain that to people. In Roll Red Roll, we see it with the boys who committed the crime and the men around them who help them cover it up. And in Victim Suspect, we see it playing out in law enforcement, in police stations, and it's just really devastating to see how entrenched victim blaming is. So, you know, how did you know that this was the next film for you? How did you know that what Ray brought to you, you were like, yep, this is it?
I'm really sorry I can't be there with everyone. Before I answer that, I feel like I need to acknowledge the violence and the horrors that have occurred over the weekend. And as someone who does work in anti-violence for many, many years, hearing from people all over the world about rape being used as an act of, terror on civilians. And obviously my heart is with all peoples being harmed. But that particular set of details is really horrifying. And I think it kind of flashes us back to what was happening in Kosovo and, you know, just the vulnerability and how rape is a tactic. I didn't know Victim Suspect would be my next film per se, but I was really moved by looking at systemic issues that drive the culture or drive the enabling or drive the excusing of it, whether it be cultural, like in Roll Red Roll around football or around, you know, really rigid gender divides. What really moved me was Ray being able to obtain that video evidence. So for me also as a storyteller, I really like to show, not tell, and being able to sort of show, how victims are being treated, how they're being spoken to, what the body language is, all of those pieces was really motivating. And also there's this idea that, you know, rape victims should report and we should trust the state or we should trust the police. And this felt like a really powerful opportunity to challenge the whole system in general. So that's why I said yes to the project, and I was really excited to also get to profile and follow Ray as she, you know, moved on the biggest story and biggest discovery of her journalism thus far.
Maybe you both can talk a little bit about how this collaboration came together. How did Netflix get involved? Did they want to make a film about rape?
You want to start, Nancy?
Let's see. It's interesting that, I mean, even, you know, when you kind of introduce the panel, that rape isn't, you know, sexual violence isn't discussed, because, you know, part of what we showed in the film also is that it's like 1 in 3 people are impacted, and like, I guess, polite society, this is such an uncomfortable topic, similar to child sexual assault, and like, it is so prevalent and so common, so we have to talk about it. You know, this film followed the Me Too movement, so I think there was more of a sort of acceptance that these stories are happening and that they're important. I think our bigger challenge actually was, you know, the why of it all. And I think Ray and I have complex understanding of why. And I think sometimes when you partner, we were very lucky to partner with Netflix because the film reached millions and millions and millions of people all over the world. But, you know, people want like this hard, this clear, simple why. Like, why is this happening? Is this a backlash to Me Too? Is this because X, Y, or Z? You know, is there some financial motivation? Or someone at the top is telling all law enforcement, you know, not to believe victims, and it's just a much more complicated state by state, county by county, slash cultural beliefs that women lie, combination of factors. So I think that was kind of the bigger hurdle, was like having a clear-cut why and being okay with the fact that it's like multiple reasons why it's happening.
Yeah, and we, you know, we pitched the project to several several other places, and Netflix was one of the more, like, most, they just seemed right out of the gate, just very understanding of what this was. And they, I thought we had a really good pitch session with them where they asked very good questions, and they already knew the problem and why this mattered. But of course their questions were gonna be, well, how are you gonna tell the story visually and walk us through that? So I really liked being in the room with them, and I just felt like we already had this sort of like kinship there.
Is the why also because trauma is misunderstood? Is that a part of it?
I think so. I think that's definitely a part of it. I think what Ray alluded to earlier about, you know, inconsistencies in the reporting come from the trauma, but also this real generational gap of what knowing someone is, like, what a stranger rape is. It's not someone jumping out of the bushes anymore, per se. It's someone like sliding into your DMs, saying they know you at a party, and then assaulting you, right? So it's basically law enforcement just doesn't quite understand how social media works. And if someone's in your phone, it doesn't mean they're your friend. It doesn't mean you dated them. So I think there are ways that perpetration is evolving to use the digital tools to know that cops don't understand these things and kind of use it to their advantage. So there are some of those pieces. And then I think Detective Hirschman, who's in our film, who's retired San Diego Police Department, you know, made it clear it's a lot of bias against victims and rape myths. And it's challenging police work. It's not easy. It's not, you know, you actually have to dig around. And instead of looking at victim behavior, you actually have to shift and try to look at perpetrator behavior. And it's like shoes on the ground police work. And what our film showed is Ray, as a journalist, actually doing the boots on the ground investigation that law enforcement didn't. And it was a lot of effort on her part.
I think that what was interesting is how, so it's trauma being misperceived as deception. And there's all this like junk science out there where these detectives will like explain, you know, oh, well, they were breathing really heavy, or they chuckled at this part, or their eyes, you know, they sort of write this stuff in their report, and I'm reading it and I'm like, so? I mean, that doesn't mean anything. You know, a victim can respond in countless ways. Some people might look like they, you know, are even like happy about something and joking, but it's just everybody responds differently. And there are ways that people respond to trauma that might look like deception, and police just are not used to thinking of it that way. But I got very used to talking to this one young woman who would chuckle while she was telling me about what happened because she was so nervous. So if you talked to her about anything that she was nervous about, she would chuckle. That was just her. But if you didn't take time to get to know her, you wouldn't understand that.
So let's talk about impact and the importance of funding for impact. I know that the impact campaign for this film is pretty robust. Nancy, do you want to start by unpacking it for us? What behaviors are we trying to change? It's probably law enforcement behavior, right?
Oh, as a start, I want to give a beautiful shout out to Anarima Bargava, who is on the board of Doc Society, of course, and that was a beautiful tribute to Jess, and who is also an advisor on our impact campaign, and was an advisor for Roll Red Roll as well. We are looking at a few different areas, policymakers at federal, state, and local levels, essentially to try and make sure that it is monitored and paid attention to if law enforcement agencies are using recantation or deception to get confessions, and using that as a means to prosecute a rape victim. So we're trying to put a few, you know, put that on watch. Prosecutors, judges, police officers, same thing. To us, the police officers and police stations are like low-hanging fruit and getting the film to those as much as possible. I think they've actually really responded positively because there are trainings that we document in the film that show this is the proper way to do an investigation, and they're getting to hear it from a law enforcement officer. And then one of the victims in our film was not treated well by her first responder nurse, so we also want to try to hit doctors, nurses, and victim advocates. We have this all on our websites. We'll share that with you. We are partnering now with legislators in Connecticut and Alabama to host screenings. And we're looking into bills that make the system more just for victims by requiring police to thoroughly investigate the sexual assault complaint. What Ray found is like they would get halfway through the investigation, drop it, decide the victim's lying, and then move to prosecute and leave out key witnesses, you know, just not finish the job, and, you know, really make sure they're not relying on rape myths to do this kind of, you know, pardon my French, half-ass police work. Ray, I will let you speak to the journalistic piece of the audiences we're trying to activate there.
Yeah, so I also want to reach journalists. And I'll say, you know, to Nancy's point, that I have been getting really great feedback and wonderful emails from advocates, people at crisis centers, police themselves. And they're like, I watched the film, great job. And I'm like, blink, blink, waiting. But then I realize, okay, this is not going to do itself. So we are working with a wonderful partner on this, Red Owl, and Eliza Licht is here, who is working with us on this campaign that Nancy is talking about. So it really is us doing it, because I am getting invites to screen the film, which is incredible, and it's usually at college campuses. But when it comes to those like much more challenging conversations where it's going to be with legislators and the DA and people who, you know, are going to be pressed a little bit, I mean, they're not going to ask us, so we will do that. but I am so grateful that people are watching it, and that's the first step. I also am reaching out to journalists, particularly on campus, like college campuses, because I do want to challenge journalists. That was another part of this reporting, is I was finding these stories because they were being reported on, and I would have the name of that alleged victim, which was helpful to me, but also meant that they were going to be bombarded by all these terrible people calling them horrible names. And I just thought, like, this is so weird. Basically, the premise of this is that they don't have a layer of protection anymore because they're not a victim, they're a criminal suspect, and this really needs to be examined across all crime reporting, this idea that just because you're arrested, you're all of a sudden, forever going to be known for that. So these women are now seeing, the impact for them is wonderful, which is that you Google their name, and the first and second Google pages are no longer Emma Mannion, charged with false reporting, lied about rape. It is Emma Mannion, survivor, speaks at Sundance, or speaks at wherever. That has been, I think, life-changing for them. It's small, but it really is impact. But it doesn't mean that we're done, because obviously we don't want this to happen to anybody else. So we are going out to Alabama, Connecticut, and other states where we know that this is happening, because that those are the people that need to hear it. And it's not just the South. I want to be very clear about that. It really is everywhere.
Yeah, just to piggyback, you know, that's a big part of the film, is that local news kind of takes the police blotter and police report and splashes mugshots all over. So I don't think we can understate how huge it is for Diane and Emma that this was scrubbed from the internet, and that was really Ray's dogged efforts to make that happen. So it's trying to activate journalists to not take police records as fact and truth and to do their own work, and then really challenge lawmakers to, and let the general public know that this is happening. And also my personal, I don't know if it's an agenda, but really making sure that survivors know that it's their choice if they want to report, and that putting it in the hands of the state or law enforcement is not necessarily a safe thing to do all the time. Mm-hmm. And they should think very carefully and not feel the burden that they have to do it to protect others, right? Mm-hmm. And I think survivors are often tasked with that burden, put themselves at risk to make that report. And we want to highlight also that until the system changes, it's not necessarily safe to do that, unfortunately. Mm-hmm.
That's a great point. Nancy, you've also said that this film is a love letter to investigative journalism, which is a beautiful sentiment. And Ray, you worked on this story for 4 years, and you're still working on it. I wonder if you can both reflect on the importance of funding for this type of work, and since we're in a room full of journalism funders, what are some insights that you have on the best ways to go about supporting this work? Right?
Yeah, I think this could have been done in less time, but only at the sake of my mental health. So I did this in 4 years because I was trying to take good care of myself, because mm-hmm. I don't think a source, I never wanted to show up to my sources like, oh yeah, I worked all night, you know, preparing for this interview. I wanted to show up well-rested, nourished, and like I was a good person for them to talk to about it, and also that I wasn't going to break down after talking to them, that they could tell me whatever they needed to tell me. So I did, you know, I feel like we took as long as we needed to, because the story required it. There were developments happening that just took forever, like public record access, which is a whole other story. And then I just really needed to give people time, you know, to process. Do you want to be in a Netflix film? Because we had people that backed out, and that's perfectly fine. And we also were very, you know, transparent that this is a big deal. Are you ready for this? And I think that everyone in that film that you'll see was ready for it. And that really mattered to me, because I wasn't going to rush anybody. And that's how I see it. And so long-term funding was incredibly important, and small size funding mattered, because before we had that Netflix money, we had nothing, just like my salary that I was getting paid for. So we had like little pieces that we put together so that I could travel to meet these young women for the first time and build trust, and not make them feel pressure that there was a ticking, you know, time, a ticking clock that they had to worry about.
Nancy?
Well, I never saw Ray take a break, so that's amazing that that was slow for her. But really, truly, one of the most dogged made my job as a documentary filmmaker easy because of how careful and beautiful she handled sources, and how dogged and endlessly, you know, efforting to get the documents and to get reports and to keep track of all of that stuff. So as a filmmaker, you know, my call to those who fund the incredibly important work of investigative journalism, we're all we got. I mean, the people in this room, journalists are like the only ones truth-telling, and then we as filmmakers can amplify. We had 8 million viewers in our first 30 days. That's a huge, huge broadcast, and I think the pairing of filmmakers and reporters and the importance of long form and taking those years to do is that's what's exciting for film platforms, because Ray had the juice. We had like, you know, golden material because of the time it took for Ray to dig around, meet people, get the trust, get the documents, and start to see the patterns. And I've done a lot of pitches in you know, film and TV land, and they want this big sprawling scope, you know, big picture stuff, and that's the kind of stuff that to do it right takes time. So I think it's really the combination of funding that painstaking, you know, Ray's one person, so she also is able to fly under the radar. Once you bring Netflix into it, it's like a whole different animal. So I think really the pairing of the two is key, and having that extra time to dig around to then bring it to the larger platform is, I think, the magical combination.
Thank you. Unfortunately, we are already over time. Ray, did you want to offer a final thought? And then we can go to Nancy for a final thought, too.
I'm just so grateful that you all care about journalism. And I think all, like, there's so many types of journalism that should be supported. This particular type is incredibly hard and taxing. And, yeah, I just hope you remember, too, you know, if you're funding a place because they won a Pulitzer, that's great. But there's people who are there who are working on something amazing who haven't, they don't have that on their resume yet. But talk to them, listen to the reporters, the young reporters in particular, who are working on wonderful things, and find, like, follow the passion, because you have to care about this to suffer through so much of it, especially for so long. So find the people who are really passionate about what they're doing, and that they, you know, care about what reporting that they want to pursue.
Nancy?
I'm grateful for Ray's trust on the Center for Investigative Journalism. And I think, documentary filmmakers are not journalists. Some are, some are not. We're not. So I think really the combination of the two is incredibly winning. And I don't really ever want to do a deep dive film without, a journalist as talented as Ray as a producing partner. So. This is just a call for partnership.
I like that. Thank you. Thank you, Nancy, for joining us remotely so much. Thank you, Ray.
Thank you.
Appreciate you guys being here.